Beautiful. Thank you, Sharon. How wonderful it is to be in the house of the Lord this morning, isn't it? Come on now, give me an amen or a something. I mean, myself. It's Sunday morning. Y'all got up, you had breakfast, you dressed up looking good. You got to be happy when you come into God's house. It's Founders Day. Boy, 73 years this church has been going and blowing and going. Randy. Ladies and gentlemen, my sidekick, Randy Hyde. The only way you can tell Randy and I apart, he has the mustache.
Well, good morning, everybody. Everybody, can you hear me? All right. On March 10th, we have our annual Spring Fling Dance. How many have been to one of those before in the past? Yeah, a lot. It always sells out. We got about 90 tickets. We're going to have about 8 decades of music. It's going to be catered by Memphis Barbecue, which is about a third of a mile north of Bay Pines on Seminole Boulevard. They're wonderful. If you take your bulletin there, you get a 10% off. They're wonderful. They've been treating us well for a long, long time. Let me ask you to do a little participation real quick here. Sorry, Pastor. Anyone who knows these musical artists or the name of the songs, please raise your hand and then keep your hand raised, okay? How about Barry Manilow? Anybody heard about Barry Manilow? Keep your hands up, okay. How about Dean Martin? Frank Sinatra? Michael Bublé? Earth, Wind, and Fire? Dave Ruth? It's going to be a lot of fun. We have a great time. It's going to be a great meal. The tickets are $15. They'll be sold out at the Welcome Center after the service here today. Make sure you get them soon because they'll go out, and we'll try to get a few more people in there. It's in the fellowship hall. We clear it out. It's wonderful. You have a great time, and it's one of the traditions we have at Church by the Sea. Enjoy your Founders Day. God bless you.
All right, Randy. He didn't say anything about Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys. I know all of y'all know all those good old favorites, don't you? Well, I want to introduce you to some. I know, but I want you to hold it. Thank you. I want to introduce you to someone. You want to know why everything works so wonderfully around here, like a well-oiled clock, right? Barbara, come on up here. I want to see you. All right. Barbara, come up here. I want to see you. Yeah, you come over here, sweet angel. Come over on this side. There you go. Barbara, come up here. Yeah, come up here. Now, Roberta, come up here. Well, no, they don't count yet. They got to be over 32. All right, everybody, I just want you to know that if anything goes right at this church, it's not my fault. This is my brain trust right here. I tell you, these are my consultants. Well, I'm telling you, if something goes right here, it's because of these dear, sweet ladies. And I just wanted to bring them, let y'all seriously know that. Anytime I want to know which way the wind's blowing, how things are moving, I stop by and I say, Barbie, what's going on, sugar doll? And then she'll tell me. Then I'll go to Barbara and I'll say, now, Barb, how we doing? And she gets a switch after me. Then I ask Roberta, and she goes, oh, Dave, you're impossible. You know. So these are three lovely ladies that I count on all the time, and I want y'all to know that. All right, give my hand, will you? All right, thank you, dear. Thank you, Barbie. Honey. No, you girls are under 32, aren't you? I mean, you know what I'm saying? Thank you. Okay. I'm just making, okay. Now then, we have an organization, a little group called Cut-Ups, and the Cut-Ups are the historians of our church, and we have reams and volumes of pictures and stories all about our church. Anybody here who is in the Cut-Ups or whoever has been, please stand up so we can acknowledge you historians of our church. Here they are right here, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much. Fabulous. Thank you. Thank you, and be seated. Now then, without further ado, Lisa Greeno, our Director of Children's Ministry.
How How's that? That sounds better. Well, the kids, our beach kids, are here today, and they are going to help bring in some information some of you may already know, and maybe you don't, about how our church was founded 73 years ago. We're very proud of them. They've worked really hard, and they're just going to take some time. They're going to sing a song for you and then ask you to join in a song with them, too. So we will let Travis begin.
Hi, I'm Reverend Philip Henry Ralph. I came to Florida to a vacation for the winters after I retired from being a minister. I am 72 years old. In 1943, I went door to door to see if there was any interest in having our own church on the beach, and there was.
In 1944, the first service was held on the first Sunday in February in their Fishermen's Union Hall. A little room became the nursery. A small warehouse room became the Sunday school. Small chairs, a pulpit, and a piano were donated by the local community.
Attended for the first service, and on the second Sunday, the attendance will be doubled.
The first offering amounted
$3.80.
In May of 1944, I sketched the building and said, "We set our goal high, knowing that what we build must be worthy of the cause we represented and worthy of the community we serve."
November 15, 1944 was the groundbreaking where our church sits today. There are the founding denominations of the members of the church: Baptist, Methodist, Congregational Community, Christian Science, Disciples of Christ, Episcopalian, Missouri Synod Lutheran, Swedish Lutheran, and Presbyterian.
Wait, who In 1946, the first service was held in what is now the parlor. Everything a church needed took place in this building. The Sunday school met on the balcony. The kitchen was under the balcony, and the tables and chairs were placed in the sanctuary for dinner. The final touches continued throughout the years, with the stained windows being put in 1949.
Church was built by Reverend Ralph, church members and community with very little money and lots of faith that the Lord would provide. Thank you for our founders building Church by the Sea 73 years ago. Thank you for this place we as a family of God call our church home. Will you all rise and join us in singing the family of God?
The words to this will be on our screen, and if you want to follow along with the refrain, that's on 419 in the Red Books.
Standing, because Sharon, we're going to start with our opening hymn.
All right. We are going to sing The Church's One Foundation.
Get your shovel. Get your mic.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please be seated. Well, that's not true, is it? You see, I get so caught up here. I enjoying the children, enjoying worship, and y'all were supposed to remain standing, weren't you? Well, sure you were. So go ahead, stand back up like you know what you're supposed to be doing here. Well, knows I don't. Oh, friends, it's a full day's work being Dave, I know that. Let's pray our prayer of invocation with one heart and one mind. Holy Lord, dwell among us with infinite power and love.
Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. Strike a spark of love in our hearts that will kindle anew our love for you and for one another. May we yield to you here in this building as we celebrate this Founders Day for your glory. May we leave this sanctuary with such love within us that you might indeed be with us. It is with our prayer, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Friends, now please be seated. Our scripture reading for this morning is taken from Ezra chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. When the builders had laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests stood in their apparel with trumpets, and the Levites, the sons of Asaph, with cymbals, to praise the Lord according to the directions of King David of Israel. And they sang, praising and giving thanks to the Lord, saying, "For the Lord is good, and his loving kindness is upon Israel forever." And all the people shouted with a great shout when they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. Yet many of the priests, the Levites, the heads of the fathers' households, the old men who had seen the first temple, they wept with a loud voice when the foundation of this house was laid before their eyes, while many shouted aloud for joy. And Heavenly Father, we do come into your presence with hearts filled with joy, filled with wonderment, filled with amazement at all the wonderful things that you have done on this beach and throughout this whole community. Church by the Sea doesn't just affect the community on the beaches, but rather it spreads out and is well famous throughout all the Tampa Bay area and throughout the United States and even in places of the world. From all the tourists and all the visitors and the snowbirds, all the dear friends that come and gather here to worship you, and all because you put a vision in one man's heart. And that man, old and ready to retire, a spark fired up inside his heart that you had placed, and through Father Ralph, you began to build this church. We know that Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone. Jesus is the one foundation of this church. But in 1945, the cornerstone for Church by the Sea was laid, and this became a house of worship for all who would be called in. Today we are a foundational lighthouse, calling everyone on the beach community to come worship you, Lord, to study, to learn of you, so that we all may become like Jesus Christ. Receive our praise, our wonderful way that we honor and glorify you, Father, for all that you have done. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Ushers, would you please come forward as we continue to worship, as we will receive the Lord's tithes and our offering. Would you please rise for the doxology? Heavenly Father, how wonderful it is for your children to gather into your house, a place that you founded, a place that you created, a place, a wonderful building filled with wonderful people who are here to celebrate, to worship, to love you, and to give instructions on how to live a godly life. You did all of this through your infinite wisdom. Now, Heavenly Father, these dear people have given their treasures, their hard-earned money. Boy, and how wonderful it is to know that we have such a wise group of elders that we call trustees. Boy, and they use the money to your glory and for your greatness. Boy, and they use it in such a way that it just spreads the ministry of Church by the Sea throughout our community. Heavenly Father, bless the gift and the giver. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our founding Lord. Amen.
We're going to sing 404, Faith of Our Fathers. It's a funny morning. Came in here and turned the heat on. Boy, it's cold. And I thought of you sweet little ladies saying, oh, it's cold in here, Dave. Now I can feel that air conditioner working this morning. That's just for you ladies, so you don't get too hot. I work it both ways, you know. But let's look at our lesson for today, see what the Lord would have us to consider. I've called the message today, The Lord's One Foundation is Jesus Christ. But I'm going to use a different text than our scripture lesson this morning. I'm going to use Luke chapter 6, verses 47 and 48. Now the Lord Jesus is teaching, and he asks us, will you come to my classroom? I have something very important. I've got to teach you. If I don't teach, you'll never learn it by yourself. Will you come? And the master begins to teach, and he says, everyone who comes to me and hears my words and acts on them, I'll show you whom he is like. He's like a man building a house who dug deep and laid a foundation on the rock, and when a flood occurred, the torrent burst against that house and could not shake it because that house had been well built. So let's dig into our foundational truth this morning, picking it up in verse 47. Let's sort of what we call, this is exegeting. It's what the theologians call it. So we begin to go through the scripture verses so that it's not just something that everybody knows a story, but do you understand it? Well, not so much do you understand it. Is this something that you practice in your life on a daily basis?
Jesus says on verse 47, everyone, Jesus excludes no one, everyone who comes to me and hears my words and acts on those words, I'll show you who that person is like. And that person, Jesus is saying, will be like God. Genesis 1:26, God says, let us make Adama. It means men, humans. Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Boy, I tell you, we go before the Lord Jesus Christ, and I'll tell you, we begin to study him. And before we'll know it, we'll start taking on the character traits of Jesus, and we'll be like Jesus. But there's a prerequisite for building a godly life. And that prerequisite means that your godly life must be founded on Jesus Christ, his righteousness, and in his word. Jesus went on to say, all who work to exhaustion, trying to build your own spiritual life the best way you know how, will never work. I don't care how righteous you may think you are. You'll always fall short. But if you want to build a godly life, Jesus said, will you come to me? Will you learn of me? That means that Jesus wants us to have a personal and an intimate relationship with him. That's all. He said, will you come? Come over to the house. Now sit down. You want something to eat? You want something to drink? Will you listen to me? Let's talk. Let's walk along the path. Let's consider. Oh, I tell you, you want to have a godly life. It begins with a relationship with Christ. So before you start building this godly life, I may suggest that you've got to have the pre-qualifications for building a godly life. Well, Dave, what are you talking about? May I suggest this, that it starts off with an excellent set of blueprints. This building started off with blueprints. You have blueprints for you to know what a godly life is to look like. And then you've got to have a master builder, because you cannot build your spiritual house by yourself. I do not call myself a carpenter. I've worked on so many projects that I now have the nickname of being not the carpenter, but the nail puller. So if I want to build me a house, well, I better go out there and I better find me an excellent person to build that house. And that person, I'm going to say I want to build a house. I think Howie Greeno is just excellent at being a carpenter. So I would say, Howie, I need to build a house. And he'd say, okay, here is the first prerequisite. You have to stay out of the way, nail puller. And then Howie would draw up a set of blueprints, and he'd show me, and he'd discuss all that with me. And then Howie would build that house for me. Only thing Howie let me do is carry the trash out. If you want to build a spiritual house, the blueprint is the Word of God, and the master builder is God. You ever try to build a spiritual life, you'll fail every time. Boy, you've got to know the Word of God. That's the blueprint. But that's just the beginning. Then God has to build that in you. You can't ever do it by yourself. To build a spiritual house, you must follow the blueprint exactly as the master builder has laid out the precise specifications. Jesus said, everyone who comes to me, the master builder, and hears my words, the blueprints, and then acts on those masterfully drawn up designs, I'll show you who that person is like. And then Jesus, very lovingly, said, you'll be like your teacher. It's enough for a disciple, for an apprentice, to become like their teacher. And your eyes will see your teacher. Your ears will hear your teacher's words. He'll say, this is the way. Live like me. Follow me. Boy, to drive home his point, Jesus gave us an illustration in a parable. And it's verse 48. Jesus said, you'll be like a man building a house who dug deep, and he laid a foundation on the rock, and a flood and a torrent burst against that house, and it could not shake it because that house had been well built. Building a spiritual life, metaphorically, I'm using this to say it's sort of like building your own house. But I'll tell you, when you start to build a house, the first thing you've got to do is you have to dig deep in order to lay a foundation on bedrock. So it says that the man who set out, he dug deep. And that word dug in the Greek, it means to dig very deep, and it actually means to never stop digging. The way a wise master builder constructs your spiritual house is first by faith in Jesus Christ, and second by studying the inerrant Word of God, digging deeper into those living truths. And a wise builder will keep on digging until they strike solid rock. Boy, now that I've struck rock, well, now I can begin to lay that foundation. And the solid rock that you want to build your life on is nothing less than the absolute truth of God. In his parable, the master builder, he begins by laying or pouring a foundation, reinforcing that foundation with mortar until it connects every joint, so that, verse 48, when, not if, but when the flood and torrents burst against that house. The floods and the torrents we understand as storms of life that crash down on you like a Category 10 hurricane or like a tsunami that just rolls over you. And I'll tell you, you can be going along minding your own business, walking down the road like Lucky LaRue, just whistling and having a great time, and get totally blindsided by this life. And then you can know, I know what's ahead. And what's ahead for me is pain and problems, heartache, and you can see it, and it's down there. No matter how it comes to you, when the sufferings of life crash against your life, your house, your life will not be shaken, Jesus says. The word shaken in the Greek, it means that it lacks the power to break it. I like that. So, your life, Jesus says, you build your life on the foundation of your faith in me and in my truth. Well, I tell you, your life will never be busted up and broken. Will it shake? Yeah. Will you go through the storms of life? Absolutely. But you'll get through it. Listen to Psalm 16:8. Any of you want to remember that? Psalm 16:8. It's one of my favorite psalms. Verse 8, because I have set the Lord continually before me. And that word set means, in the Hebrew, it means I put a place, I made a place for God. Because I've set the Lord continually before me, I've made a place for him. Because God and his truth is set at my right hand, I absolutely will not be shaken, no matter what. The spiritual house that God desires to build in you will never be shaken because your house has been well built on the blood of Jesus Christ and his righteousness. Can't get a more stronger foundation than that. So, who or what can break us, can separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, weapons? No. just as it is written. In all these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through Jesus Christ, who loved us. And I am convinced that neither death nor life nor any other created thing will ever be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Jesus Christ. And dear friends, this is our one foundation. Amen. All right. I'm looking at the clock over there. Well, it's Founders Day, you know, I thought I'd... Sorry, here we go. Let's see if we can't glean some wisdom from the Master's teaching this morning. The Apostle Paul writes, "According to the grace of God which was given me, like a wise master builder, I laid a foundation." That's the Gospels in the New Testament epistles. "And another is building on those biblical truths. But each person must be careful how you build on that foundation." There's a serious undertone in the message today. So many of us, I know because I've been one, takes one to know one. We get saved, and boy, and it's great, and it's wonderful, and we go on about our life, and it's good. But then things kind of come and hit us from here and there, and boy, our foundation isn't so strong. And that's because we haven't really spent time in the Word of God. Now listen, let me say something about this right now. One of the greatest gifts I've ever received is a collection of the Gospels without chapters and verses in it. And it was in a modern English translation. And so I picked it up and I just started reading. I'm very dyslexic. I always read backwards, you know, right to left. It's crazy. Boy, but I start reading this, and I start reading it like a story. And all of a sudden, boy, it just jumps off the pages. And now I don't know, well, is that chapter 5, verse 2? I don't know. I think it's on page 496. I think it's somewhere in the middle of that page right there. I know where to go. Boy, and I get reading it. Boy, and I go, oh, you're kidding. I never knew that. Well, why didn't that old preacher tell me about that? Boy, you just start reading. And the Holy Spirit always works through the Word. Oh, and it'll grip your heart. And you say, I didn't even know I needed that. Oh, and there it'll be. Well, I've read this 51 times. Oh, and there it'll be. Well, and the only thing I can tell you, Church by the Sea, the only thing Church by the Sea lacks, and by the way, this is every church that has ever existed or will exist, is a perpetual, continual re-firming up the foundation through the blueprints of the Word of God. We've got to get into the Word of God. Well, there are two principles that I suggest for maintaining a solid foundation. The first principle is obediently acting on the Word of truth. When you act on the Word of truth, when you do what the Bible says, you begin to build godly character. You won't even notice it. You just say, well, I don't do that anymore. Well, somebody came up and said, well, I'm like this. And you, oh, I didn't know that. Well, that's the Holy Spirit inside there. He's teaching you. He's working in you. He's removing those things, and he's putting something else in its place. You'll begin to build godly character, wisdom beyond your years, righteous understanding, clarity of discernment, and you'll have strength for today. Now, the second principle. Boy, pay close attention. Very close attention. Because some preachers will get up here and say, now you got to get out there and you got to get doing this, got to get doing this, got to get doing this. I don't say you got to get doing nothing. The only reason I'm asking you to get into the Word of God is because that's the way God speaks to you. He speaks through His Word. So listen. Unless the Lord builds your spiritual house, you labor in vain. Well, I've read that Bible from the front page all the way to the back and the back page to the front, and I've done it 28,000 times just in the last 2 hours. I'm a fast reader. Boy, and it'll do you absolutely no good. Boy, you get reading. Boy, I'll do that. I'll get up here and I'll start reading something. Oh, no. It's an honor for a man to keep aloof from strife. Yeah, I was going to get mixed up in that confrontation. Oh, and the Lord will stop me right there, and I can't read anymore. Well, but I got to read more. Well, no, Dave, let's deal with this. How were you going to deal with that situation? Well, I was going to go out there and bluster and bull and do my thing. Oh, I was just going to hang back and not do it. Davy, how was I supposed to handle that? Supposed to handle that in your love, in your wisdom, in your truth. Lord, you've got to give me wisdom. You've got to give me truth. You've got to give me understanding. Boy, and he will. Jesus will never teach you anything unless you ask him to teach you. Every spiritual house is built by someone. But please remember that the master builder of all things is God plus no one. Church by the Sea, our foundational heritage started with the Lord Jesus Christ, then through the great apostles, from them to the early church fathers and church mothers, and then ultimately it came down to us on Madeira Beach through the Reverend Philip Ralph and his wife Mary. And then those wonderful saints of Church by the Sea who have gone on before us. 73 years we've enjoyed wonderful worship, wonderful godly teaching in this house. Our responsibility is to maintain the solid foundation of Church by the Sea and then to continue to build on that foundation for those kids that are sitting back there in the corner. Now, when I was sitting in the Baptist church, because I'm sure I had done something wrong, someone thought I needed a little churching up, and I'd slip into the back corner back there because I knew God hated me. Then, boy, I began to listen. Someone said, oh, God loves you, boy. Now, you kids back there, I want you to understand that it's hard to swallow this traditional service, and y'all need to hear that. It's tough for them. They don't enjoy it the way you do. You know why we have a traditional service here? You have any idea? Because I want you to have a traditional service? Absolutely not. Because you want to have a traditional service. Now, come on, I need to have an amen on that. That's what you like. And then I go over there on Wednesday night and I listen to Johnny and he's in there singing praises with those kids and they're playing music like I never heard the like. Well, what in the world is Johnny teaching them now? It's probably that rock and roll music. Come on now, I'm playing. Oh, he plays music those young folks like. Then at 11 o'clock, you know, we're now having over 100 people come to the 11 o'clock service. And it's not necessarily snowbirds. Well, they're coming because they like that kind of, don't ever come to it, I promise you. Don't ever come to the 11 o'clock service. You'll think, oh boy, Dave's lost it, you know. But those folks like it, see. And so what we constantly want to be doing is we want to be making sure that solid foundation is right for us, absolutely. And then it's right for those 11 o'clockers, and it's right for those young adults that are sitting back there. And I'll tell you, I've sat there and I have listened to their youth minister, Johnny Grubbs, teach them, and he is one of the most marvelous, greatest teachers I've ever heard. And I've said, Johnny, I need you to preach for me. He says, absolutely not. God called me to the youth, not to those folks. Of course, you've heard Johnny. He's done a wonderful job. He can teach anything. He can even come into the office and teach me. So, with nothing else to say, other than Jesus Christ loves you, and you are all treasured by God, let God build your spiritual house. Amen. Sharon, come on up and lead us in some music. Folks, y'all stand up and stretch now as we continue to worship the Lord in song.
Okay, we're going to close with Christ is Made, the Sure Foundation.
Dear friends, the cut-ups, our church historians, have laid out some beautiful displays of our church's history in the fellowship hall. Now then, I've let us off a little early this morning. I took pity on you. Now, real seriously, you'll do yourself a wonderful service if you'll go back to the fellowship hall, pick up a cookie and a coffee, and just walk by the tables and just begin to look. Boy, it'll surge in your heart. And you'll go, oh my goodness, I don't belong just to this group of people here. Boy, I tell you, I'm part of the history of this church. And you'll go all the way back into those early years. It'll warm your heart. Please stop by the fellowship hall. Don't worry about the parking. That's Tim's problem out there. Would you receive the benediction of the Lord? The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you. And may the Lord continue to bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon each and every one of you and give you his peace. For the Lord loves you. Leave now this wonderful sanctuary in the love and in the joy and the peace of God. Go in peace. The Lord loves you. Amen.